In this video, that is part 3 of this balancing robot series, I will explain the workings of the main program loop. In the first video, I explained how to build this robot, and in the second video, I explained the setup part of the Arduino program, including the communication between the various parts. So make sure to check them out as well. The main program consists of a constant loop that is executed every 4 milliseconds, or 250 times per second. This frequency is based upon personal experience and is a balance between time to do stuff and performance. So it's not calculated or anything. In this line, the variable loop timer is set at the current value of the microsecond timer, incremented by 4000 microseconds. At the end of the main program loop, there is a while loop that will hold the current loop as long as the loop timer variable is larger than the microsecond timer of the Arduino. After that, the loop timer variable is set again, and the next loop is started. And this creates a solid 250 Hz loop time. Now please note that when you're adding your own code, you have to make sure that the main program loop does not exceed the 4000 microseconds. Otherwise, the angle calculations will not work properly, as I will explain later, and the robot will not function properly. Okay, enough about the loop time. Let's start analyzing the main program loop. First, there is a check for received serial data from the nunchuck transmitter. Serial data is received in the Arduino's rotating memory buffer with the use of an interrupt routine, and you don't have to worry about it. This will all happen in the background. The serial available function represents the number of new bytes in the buffer. So if there are new bytes available, the if statement is true. Inside the if statement, one byte is read from the serial buffer and loaded in the receive byte variable for later use. One byte from the nunchuck transmitter holds all the information regarding to the robot motion and will be checked every program loop. So if the transmitter sends two bytes at one time, the first byte is read in the first loop and the second byte immediately replaces the first byte in the second loop. Now we need some sort of expiration time, otherwise the robot will keep moving when the transmitter stops sending bytes. Every loop, the receive counter variable is incremented until it holds the value 26. When the receive counter variable is 26, the receive byte is cleared and the robot stops its current motion. Because every loop takes 4 milliseconds, the total expiration time of the received byte is 25 times 4 is 100 milliseconds. To guarantee a smooth movement of the robot, the transmitter has to send a new byte within these 100 milliseconds. This line reads the battery voltage from the analog input 0 and stores it in the battery voltage variable. The analog input of the Arduino can only handle a maximum of 5 volt. The LiPo battery is 12.6 volt when fully charged and will destroy the analog input. That is the reason why there is a voltage divider on the schematic. A current will flow through these resistors and the voltage will divide itself over the resistors in relation to the resistor values. In this case, 2.5. Now there is a catch, because the diode creates a voltage drop that is current depending, as you can see here in the datasheet of the 1N4007 diode. In the previous video, we set both stepper controllers at approximately 150 milliamps. This makes the total constant current consumption of the robot approximately 350 milliamps. In this diagram, we can see that a 350 milliamp current results in a 0.85 volt constant voltage drop over the diode. The Arduino uses a 10-bit analog to digital converter and uses the internal 5-volt as maximum reference. In short, 5-volt on the analog input will give a digital value of 1023. By connecting the analog input to ground, the result will be a digital value of 0. By multiplying the 5 volts by 2.5, the voltage over the voltage divider can be calculated. So, when the connected voltage is 12.5 volt, the analog read value will be 1023. By multiplying the 1023 by 1.222, we get a value of 1250. This value represents the 12.5 volt multiplied by 100. By adding 85, that is the 0.85 volt for the voltage drop over the diode, the voltage of the connected battery can be calculated. Now that we have the battery voltage available, it's possible to do something useful with it. In this part, the LED is lit and the low bed variable is set to 1 when the battery voltage drops below 10.5 volt. The 800 value is used to prevent the low battery warning becoming active when the Arduino is connected to the computer without a battery. Now that the housekeeping stuff is done, it's time to measure the angle with the MPU6050. First, the raw accelerometer data is pulled from the MPU6050 as explained in the previous video. The balancing calibration value is subtracted, and the result is limited to plus or minus 8200 to prevent a division by zero. As I already explained in another video, it's now possible to calculate the angle of the robot with the use of the A-sine function. I will put a link to this video in the description. In short, and explained in detail in the other video, the accelerometer value is incrementing as a sine function when the angle of the robot is increasing. With the A-sine function, the angle of the robot can be calculated. The 57.296 value is used because the A-sine function is in radians and not in degrees. This part of the code handles the start of the robot. In the first video, I showed that the robot starts when you slowly put it in an upright position. Every loop, that is 250 times per second, the angle of the robot is measured with only the accelerometer. If the angle of the robot is between plus or minus 0.5 degrees of its balancing point, the angle gyro variable is set to the current angle and the start variable is set to 1 to indicate that the robot is active. Next, the jaw and pitch gyro values are pulled from the MPU6050 as explained in the previous video. In this line, the calibration gyro offset of the pitch is subtracted. Because the main loop is running at 250 Hz, we know that the gyro value is the approximate average movement of the previous 4 milliseconds. In the datasheet of the MPU6050, we can see that if the gyro outputs 131, the gyro rotates at 1 degree per second. But we don't measure in degrees per second, we measure in degrees per 4 milliseconds or 250 Hz. So 250 times 131 should result in 1 degree per second. This is the equation that I used to calculate this 0.000031 value. So with this calculation, we can determine the traveled angle in the previous 4 milliseconds. By subtracting this traveled angle from the angle gyro variable, the actual angle is updated to the new position. In short, at the start moment, the angle gyro variable is set to the accelerometer angle. After that, the gyro is used to add or subtract the movements of the robot during operation. This is done because the gyro is less sensitive to vibrations. The only downside is that the gyro value will drift over time. And that is why this line is added. Every loop, the gyro angle is slightly corrected with the accelerometer angle by the use of a complementary filter. Because the corrections are so small, the accelerometer peaks caused by the vibrations will stay unnoticed. Again, I made a video about this gyro accelerometer fusion before. If you are really interested in this subject, you definitely need to watch this video. I will put a link in the description. By the way, you might have noticed this line that is currently commented out. But don't be fooled, it's a very important line. Let me explain. When you mount the gyro on the robot, there is an acceptable chance that the gyro isn't mounted perpendicular to the axis of the robot. This can also be caused during the manufacturing of the MPU6050 breakout board. As a result, the pitch angle is also influenced by the rotation of the robot. So when the robot is rotating, the pitch angle increases or decreases. The robot starts to pitch forward or backwards and start to increase its speed. To compensate for this behavior, the gyro value of the jaw axis is used. Because the influence is so small, the compensation is also very small. For my own robot, I used 0.000003 and now the robot is rotating at one spot. And after all these calculations, the variable angle gyro holds the real-time angle of the robot. Our first goal is to keep the robot at a 0-degree angle so the robot will stay upright. The easiest way to do this is by using a PID controller. As explained before, the speed of the motors react linear by the use of some calculations. And that is why we can get away with the PID controller. And that is all done in this part. If you want to learn the details about PID controllers, you have to watch this video that I made about PID controllers. It's for quadcopters, but the principle is the same. In short, a PID controller has two inputs: the current actual angle of the robot and the desired angle. When the robot is not moving, the desired angle is 0 degrees. By measuring the difference between the actual angle of the robot and the desired angle, the PID calculates an output that is used for controlling the stepper motors. Again, please watch the video about PID controllers if you want to learn more about this subject. I'll put a link in the description. This line adds a little dead band, meaning that when the PID output is between plus and minus 5, the output is set to 0. This prevents the nervous behavior when the robot is in balance, as you can see here. This is without dead band. And this is with dead band. Okay, despite the fact that the robot is pretty stable, it sometimes happens that it will fall. And when this happens, the motors must stop working. Here you can see that when the robot tips any further than plus or minus 30 degrees, the variable start is set to 0. And the PID controller is reset to prevent sudden movements during the next start. Also, the self-balanced PID set point is reset. But we get to that later. Okay, and now we get to the part where the control calculations are done. First, we need to separate the PID output for the left and right motor. That is done here. As explained before, the robot is controlled by a single byte that is called receive byte. The first or least significant bit is set when the robot needs to turn. The second bit is set when the robot needs to turn the other way. This is done in the remote control program. In this line, the receive byte is tested to see if the first bit is set. This is done with a bitwise AND function. So this test result is true when the least significant bit of the received byte is 1. The other bytes are ignored because they are set to zero. In this part, the PID left and right are increased or decreased by the turning speed variable that was set in the beginning of the program. This will change the speed of the motors and the robot is able to rotate. Same test is performed for the third and fourth bit. These bits represent forward and backward movement. In contrast to turning, this is done by changing the angle of the robot, so it will lean forward or backwards. The initial target angle of the PID controller is set to 2.5 degrees, as you can see here. This is done in small incrementing steps every loop. This makes the movement of the robot more fluid. The next line is interesting. It decreases the PID set point by 0.005 degrees every loop until the PID controller output is larger than the max target speed variable. This will slowly increase the angle of the robot until it reaches a certain speed. This makes it possible to use this robot on pile carpets, as you can see here. The robot directly adjusts its position to 2.5 degrees. But this is not enough to get the robot to move. So it keeps adjusting its angle until the PID output is larger than the max target speed variable. The next part is also very interesting. Now, it's almost impossible to perfectly balance the robot and make it come to a complete standstill. Also, a small angled surface will cause the robot to move. So, when the desired angle, that is the PID set point, is zero, the robot should come to a complete standstill. To get this to work, the output of the PID controller, that is the speed of the robot, is monitored. If the robot is moving, these lines adjust the self-balance PID set point variable in very small steps. As you can see in this line, the self-balance PID set point variable is subtracted from the PID set point variable. As a result, the robot will constantly adapt its position until it comes to a complete standstill. Here you can see that when the angle of the surface is increased, the robot will move, but eventually come to a complete standstill. The next line acts like a parachute brake function. When the PID output is larger than 10 or smaller than minus 10, the error between the desired angle and the actual angle of the robot is adjusted. As a result, the robot will lean more in the opposite direction as it is moving. You can see this when the robot is pushed in a certain direction. Okay, this brings us to the last part of the main loop. It calculates the pulse time for the stepper controllers. As explained in the previous video, these calculations are needed to compensate for the logarithmic behavior of the stepper motor speed versus the pulse time. And last, the pulse frequency, or time between the pulses, is calculated for both stepper motors in this part. It's important to know that all the 400 values that you see here in the pulse time calculations and here in the PID calculations are related. You should not change these values unless you know exactly what you are doing. And now the left motor and right motor variables hold the delay time for the stepper motors. In these two lines, the left motor and right motor variables are copied so that the subroutine can use them for generating the next pulse. And that brings us to the final part of the code that generates the pulses for the stepper motor controllers. This is the interrupt subroutine that is executed every 20 microseconds. Every time the interrupt routine is executed, the throttle counter left motor variable is incremented by 1. In the next line, there is a test to see if the throttle counter left motor variable is larger than the throttle left motor memory variable. At some time it will, and the throttle counter left motor variable is reset to zero. Next, the throttle left motor memory variable is loaded with the latest delay time that was calculated by the PID controller. If the new variable is smaller than zero, meaning that the motor has to move in the opposite direction, the corresponding digital output 3 is set low, so the stepper controller knows that the step is in the opposite direction. After that, the throttle left motor memory variable is multiplied by -1 to get a positive value. If the throttle left motor memory variable is positive, the output 3 is set high. The second time the code is executed, the throttle counter left motor variable is 1 and the output 2 is set high. The next loop, output 2 is set low again. This produces a 20 microsecond pulse. And now the waiting starts until the throttle counter left motor variable is larger than the throttle left motor memory variable. And the same is done for the right motor. And that's it. You should now be able to fully understand the code and where needed improve it for your own purposes. I hope you enjoyed this video and take the time to give this video a thumbs up if you liked it. Thank you for watching and see you next time.